God's people said amen.
Amen.
How y'all doing?
Good.
This is the day that the Lord has made. And I like how he didn't put a decision in there. He said, I will rejoice. Not because I woke up on the wrong side of the bed. I'm just happy I woke up at all. I will. I will rejoice and be glad. And it's good to see everyone that put forth an effort out to come this morning. Happy Father's Day.
Yeah.
I know we don't get a lot of sales. I don't see a lot of commercials. They might not even come to us when they want some cereal. But where would we be if it wasn't for fathers? Even though we may sometimes feel like they are in short supply, there are still some out here trying to love our wives and love our children and show the world that at least in this black culture, there are still some good fathers. Amen. So today, pat yourself on the back. Only get one day, so pat hard. Leave your shoulder sore. And thank God for all of y'all. And like I said earlier, thank the Lord for those of us that still have our parents.
Amen.
So happy Father's Day to those that have already gone on to be with the Lord.
Amen.
And always remember, no matter what's going on in your life, it's always a great time to praise the Lord.
Amen.
We're still in the month of June, and this has been our month on forgiveness. So turn with me to Luke chapter 15. Chapter 15. And we'll be looking at verses 16 through 24. Luke chapter 15, verses 16 through 24. Luke 15, 16 through 24, and it reads, And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk of the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise, go unto my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he rose and came to his father, but when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said unto his servants, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his finger, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. Just for a brief moment, I'd like to speak from the topic, wiping the slate clean. Wiping the slate clean. Technology is wonderful, and I get a chance to go to my children's schools, and everyone has laptops, everyone has tablet, they got smart boards and all of those good things, and praise the Lord for it. But when I was in school, had a big old green thing in front of the classroom named a chalkboard.
Yeah.
Teachers use it, they'll First day of school, put their name, this is Miss such and such. And next day you come in, they might have the objectives of the year. But with the chalkboard, the information was only important if it was on the board. At any given time, she could call a dust eraser and wipe the slate clean. So if you didn't get it before she erased it, some teachers you just didn't get it. Because they put it on the board for you to see it, but when it was time to flip to something else, they would get a dust eraser and wipe the board clean.
Yeah.
This morning, I'm here to tell you that all of us are chalkboards. And there's only two people that hold a chalk. Sometimes we let the devil hold the chalk. And sometimes we let God hold the chalk. But when we let the devil hold the chalk and he starts writing on the slate of our lives, the messages that he leaves are not godly. The thoughts that he writes in the slate on the tablets of our mind are not godly. So we need sometimes to fall on our knees and say, Lord, wipe the slate clean. Sometimes, I know the song says, I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. But some mornings you wake up, Jesus is nowhere close to your mind, and you find yourself in the middle of the day saying, Lord, wipe the slate clean. And I'm so glad that the things of the world are written with chalk and not written in permanent marker. Oh, I say it again. The things of the devil, the things of this world is only written in chalk and not written in permanent, because if it was written in permanent, we'd be damned to hell never to rise again. But since it's in chalk, God can come along and wipe the slate clean and make me brand new again, creating me a clean heart and renew a right spirit in me. Lord, wipe the slate clean. Is there anybody here that needed a slate clean before? You've been some places you wasn't supposed to go. You said some things you wasn't supposed to say. You thought some thoughts you wasn't supposed to think. But God came along and wiped. Wipe the slate clean. I can't testify, but I've been some places I wasn't supposed to go. I've said some things I wasn't supposed to say. That's why it behooves us. And when we in there, don't stay in it. Ask God to forgive us. In the text today, we found a boy that did too much. What he did could have cost him his life. For those of you that don't know the story, the youngest of two boys went to his dad and said, Daddy, give me what's mine. And I don't understand and thank the Lord for a father like that, because if it was me, I'm saying, boy, ain't I still alive? Well, until I'm gone, all this is mine. But the father knew that this was a lesson that needed to be learned, even though it probably hurt his heart. He gave it to him anyway. What he asked his father for was really killing his daddy off. And in those times, a request like that was cause for death. But he gave it to him anyway. And as a loving father, sometimes we have to exhibit tough love. Even though we know the road you headed down is wrong, the path you're trying to take is not the right one, but some lessons are better learned when you buy.
Yeah.
I used to want to wear Jordans all the time, and I'm the middle of five children, and Pops never bought me none until I had my children. I see why. Now I find myself at the clearance rack. I find myself going to the back of the store where the shoes have already been discontinued because those things is high. And all he came back and told me later on, he said, now you see why I couldn't do it? You only got three, I had five, and what now? I said, Daddy, the best lesson is a bought one. So he let that boy go on out and do his thing.
Yeah.
Knowing he was gonna mess it up. He went out there, and we've all been there with the car running, you got plenty of friends. When you got the job and you got a little over your bills, boy, everybody ready to party. But when you only, you got the 2 weeks notice and the money is a little strange, you call somebody, they don't even answer the phone. The young man found himself with plenty of friends until he ran out of money. The Bible called it gonna take nothing but time and opportunity, and all of us can get caught up in righteous living. We can't point our finger at each other, because at the end of the time, we can fall. And this young man was so broke, he did something that was against his whole character and culture. He found himself in a pig pen. Yeah, I'm asking him, man. I had pigs right beside my house. Those were nasty jokers. They eat anything. It don't matter, it can stay, it can be 12 years old, put it in a trough. And come back, and I bet you'll be gone. And him being a Jew, they didn't even associate with poor. Oh, but life has a way. And when you're not walking with God, he'll have you in places you say it should never be. That's why you don't ever say what you'll never do, because God got a way. Or put you with that girl you said should never be. Beat you at that job you say you'll never have. He found himself at the big pen. And I'm getting to my first point. It's three valuable lessons in wiping the slate clean. Three valuable lessons for wiping the slate clean. First lesson we learn is learn from your pig pen predicament. Learn from your pig pen predicament. The boy had went and got a job doing something well below of who he is. And all of us may not have found ourselves at a pig pen, but all of us have had pig pen predicaments. When you woke up the next morning and found out the bed you were laying in wasn't the right one, that's a pig pen predicament. When you go in the store and you pass by the Cokes and the Sprites, that's a pig pen predicament. And all of us have been there, and all of us, if you've not been there, you're on your way there. But the thing is, when you're there, you got to learn from it. It's not a mistake if you keep doing it. You got a problem. You form a habit. So when you get into your pig pen predicament, you got to do what he said. He said he came to himself. That's why the Bible say train up a child in the way that he or she should go. So when they are old, they will not depart. All he's saying is when they get in a pig pen predicament, they got the power to come to their self. I know better than what I'm doing. Mom taught me better than this. Dad showed me better than this. White, wipe the slate clean.
The boy down there seen all them doggone apple hulls and leftover chitlins and all that stuff. He's like, I'm not finna eat this. How in the world did I get here? And the only way you can come out the pig pen, you got to answer that question. How in the world did I get here? My mom and dad raised me right. I graduated from school and college. How did I get here? And the first thing, you got to remember where you left God. When that boy got that stuff from his daddy and left, he left God and his daddy. And some of us, if we don't watch it, we'll leave God where he is so we can do what we want to do. We'll leave God at home when we try to go somewhere we're not supposed to go. We'll leave God at home when we try to do something we're supposed to do. But when you get there and you feel uncomfortable, you come to yourself. I don't need to be here. What if Miss Hayes finding out? I don't need to be here. What if Dickie Hill find this out? Baby, it's bigger than your feelings. You got to worry about your witness. You got to wipe the slate clean. You got to learn from your pig pen predicaments. And I'm here to tell you, as long as you're breathing, you got a chance to fall in them. Don't ever think you know the Lord enough to where you exempt from falling in the pig pen. Because you know a couple of scriptures. Because you're blessed and highly favored. Because you're too stressed to be, you're too blessed to be stressed. God has a way to find you out. Next thing you know, you'll be like, Lord, I need you. And I believe I can say this without fear of contradiction. All of us have had that prayer, Lord, if you get me out of this. I won't ever, 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 ever do shaped in iniquity, none of us are exempt from trouble. And he asked for the trouble. Think about that stuff you asked for. And then figured out later on, I don't think I wanted this. Because if you keep pushing the Lord, he'll let you get some stuff you don't need to get your hands on. That boy didn't need that stuff his daddy gave him. He didn't know what he was doing. But if you think you're grown, sometimes God will test you and let you be grown. I ain't grown. I'm a child of God. Not an adult of God. I'm a child of God. Because he said, suffer ye little children. If they come to me like a child, ain't no grown-ups in heaven, only children of God. And he gave him stuff, and the boy found himself in a pig pen. But thank the Lord, at his pig pen, he realized there's something better than this. For you to come out the pig pen, you got to realize there's something better than this. And some people that are still at the pig pen, they're okay with where they're at. That's why they've been there for 15 years. Because they're okay with it yet. But when you've been walking with God, all I want from God is the best God has for me. And if I'm not in the best place God has for me, I got to get out of there. Amen. And that young man looked down at the sloppy and said, I got to get out of here. How many people that work for daddy got more bread to spare? I got to get out of here. Because even if I can't go back as a son, I can go back as a servant. You got to learn from the pig pen predicaments. The second lesson we find, valuable lesson we find in here, your decision does not change your position. Woo! Your decision does not change your position. See, Mike here this morning, he probably won't ever tell, but Mike will probably testify, boy, I did some stuff. But 2 seats over from him is his dad. No matter what he did, when he got back to daddy's house, he still was son. Now, daddy, while I was gone, I did some stuff that you probably would snap my neck if you find out. But when I walk back in the house, I'm still your son. The boy did that, took his daddy money, went and blew it, found himself in a pig pen. He made some bad decisions. But the text says, daddy seen him afar off. And I can see his daddy. Every day he been gone, sitting out there on that rocking chair, looking down that road. He's like, that boy don't know what he's doing. And one day there's going to be some dust coming from down that way. Day after day, rocking in that chair. And then one day he seen that dust that he'd been looking for, and he hopped off that porch and he said he met him where he was. There's two things I like about that. He met him where he was and lets him know, boy, I was looking out for you and I'll come to where you at, so when you get here, they can't tell where you come from. They can't tell you've been to the pig pen once I get to you, and I'm so happy I can raise my hand. I look good, I don't look like I've been at the pig pen because God met me where I was. I was sinking deep in sin, seeking to rise no more, but the mouth of the sea heard my despairing cry from the water. He left me and said, hey, safe am I, your decisions don't change your position. Your decisions don't change your position. Daddy met him afar off. And if anybody been like me, we'd have been like, the son that left got to practice what we're going to say when we get home. Suppose we didn't need 11 pulling in at 1. You will change a perfectly good tie just to say you had a flat. He said, let me see what I said there. I blew it as your son. I should be, you should call me son no more, but can you hire me as your servant? I think that sounds good. That is where we go with it, man. If you look at the text, he never even got to the servant part. He said, Dad, I seen in his heaven, and I seen in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Then daddy started talking. Ah, you said it again. He went. He said, daddy, I blew it. Everything you told me to do, I went opposite. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. And then daddy started talking. Because daddy was like, boy, you talking out the side of your neck. Go get me a robe. Go get me a ring. Go get me some shoes. Because if I put the stuff on you, they can't tell where you come from. I met you, look like a bum, but when you walk back in, you're going to look like my boy. Your decision don't change your position. We all messed up, but God still loves us. What I love about the Lord, he knew what was in you before he called you anyway. Don't let that guilt help stop you from leaning on the Lord. Don't let that guilt stop you from coming to church. God knew you messed up. Tell him you're sorry and get back in position. Your decision, don't change your position. Because from here on out until God calls us home, we're going to make some bad choices. Some of them we know we're doing. We think them out. We plan them out before we do it. And then find ourselves caught up in some stuff we are supposed to. Lord, help me. And thank the Lord, he hears our faintest cry and he answers by and by, because your decision don't change your position. I'm saved. But sometimes I don't look like it. Sometimes I don't sound like it. Sometimes I don't think like it. But oh, when I fall off the buggy, he'll pick me up, dust me off, and set me back where I'm supposed to be. He said, go get some stuff and put it on my boy. I'll never see my son looking like this. And that's why you look so good in the community. That's why you look so good at your job. God got you. God got you covered. He put his glory on top of you. He put his blood on top of you. He put his righteousness on top of you. So they'll never know what you look like on the inside, because you're covered by the Lord. Lord, wipe the slate clean. Because if there's anything I know how to do, I know how to mess up. Ooh, the good that I would do. I find myself not doing it. Oh, Lord, I'm trying to do better, but he'll pick you up, dust you off, and put you back in your position. Three valuable lessons to wiping the slate clean. The first lesson is you got to learn from your pig-pen predicament. Secondly, your decision does not change your position. And the third one, happy Father's Day. The Father is waiting to wipe the slate clean. The Father is waiting to wipe the slate clean. I said it a minute ago, he said far off, but the words say a great ways off. The same place you left the Lord, the same place he waited for you to get back to. And you get back to him, don't benefit him, it benefits you. Notice how the saying, you gonna need me before I need you. Use this organism, somebody wanna give you a fucking $20 back. You gonna need me before I need you. That is what God says to us every day, baby, you gonna need me before I need you, because I can make another you. Everything that I've invested in you, I can go invest that in the person right next door. But the Father is waiting for us to get back to where we're supposed to be. Guess what? Daddy never left the house, but he was looking. Christ ain't going to chase you down, but he looking. Lord, I stand at the door and knock. If any man would invite me in, I'll sup with him, and he with me. But guess what? He ain't gonna take the door off the hinges. He ain't gonna pick the lock. You gonna have to open up and let him in, because he's waiting. And look what he got for the boy while he was waiting. The boy went out, took half got back and got a new robe, new ring, new shoes, and a big calf. Say it. He left, took half of everything, came back, new robe, new ring, new shoes, fat calf. He came back to more than what he left me. Because Christ is standing right there waiting to put you back in position and have the world looking at you like you never left. When that boy made it back, ain't nowhere in the text where he said he went and washed himself off. Ain't nowhere where he said he dipped off in the water and came out. And look what daddy did when he got to him. He said, oh boy, you look bad. He kissed him. This boy just left a hog pen. He smelled like hog. Looked like he ain't had a haircut in 3 or 4 months. But when daddy got to him, he kissed him. Think about your children when they go off and did some stuff you ain't supposed to do, but when they get to the house, like, God, don't come in here and eat. Because you left don't mean that I don't want your presence. Don't mean I don't love you no more, because look at it from daddy's point of view. When daddy seen that boy coming down the road, it could not have been him meeting him. It could have been the people of the land. And they could have come strung him up and hung him for what he did to his dad. But daddy know I got to get to him before they get to him, because they don't love him like I do. And I'm here to tell you, you got some folks in your contacts, but they don't love you like God do. I know we sleep beside some beautiful men and women, but they don't love you like God do. Because who can go to Calvary and die for somebody that's spit in their face? Who can go to Calvary and die for somebody who plucked their beard? Who can go and die to Calvary for somebody that whipped them on his back 40 lashes, minus once, pissed them in his side, gave him vinegar to drink, but he still died, went in the grave, rolled early the third day morning to come back and say, baby, I love you. Baby, I'm rooting for you. I'm your number one fan. If you make one step, he'll make two, because Father is waiting to wipe the slate clean. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. He's waiting to wipe the slate clean, but he's not going to chase you down. He's in that same place he was when you left him. Daddy didn't have to go nowhere. He knew that son was coming back. And guess what? Some of us been gone so long, God ain't forgot. He know you're coming back. Amen. But the thing is, how long is it going to take?